skincare nerds, welcome back. So I really don't like drama, and I actually wasn't planning on making any commentary videos on my channel at all, but I feel like as a creator in the skincare space, I kind of have a responsibility to talk about anything that happens in the skincare world that might affect you. And that can be anything from my honest reviews of products, to helping you figure out how to get rid of acne, to shedding light on major issues that come up to help keep brands in check. And this story is one that I really can't ignore. And that's the controversy surrounding the Purito Centella Unscented Sunscreen. It's a story that starts with some suspicions on a Reddit thread, then goes behind the scenes into how sunscreens are actually made, and then ends with a much bigger question about whether we can even trust our sunscreens at all. Oh, and it also features a couple FBI raids. To be clear, they weren't on Purito, but we'll get to that. So grab yourself a cup of tea, cause it's about to get wild, y'all. Okay, so before we get started, I just want to say that I really don't want any hate to go out to any of the people involved in this story. Let's give people the benefit of the doubt, and please don't make any judgments until you've watched the entire video. So let's get into it. Purito is a Korean skincare brand that a lot of people love because they're cruelty-free, vegan, and super responsive to their customers. They even launched fragrance-free versions of their Centella Green line for sensitive skin types that don't get along with essential oils. But the one product they're really known for is the Centella Green Level Unscented Sunscreen. Everyone from Hiram to James Welsh have said it's their favorite sunscreen. And it's really easy to see why. It's sensitive skin friendly and it's good for all skin types. There's no white cast, it's not greasy, it's not sticky, it doesn't smell like a chemical plant, and it really just feels like you're wearing a very lightweight moisturizer. All of that while still giving you amazing protection with an SPF of 50+ and PA+++++. It really seemed like it answered all of the complaints that anyone has ever made about a sunscreen. It almost seemed like too good to be true. So let's go back to 2019 when the sunscreen first launched. There had been some suspicion on Reddit building that Purito sunscreen didn't offer the level of protection that was marked on the label because they only use two chemical filters, Uvinol A+ and Uvinol T150. Chemical sunscreen filters, by the way, basically just absorb the sun's UV rays. And formulating sunscreens basically just involves mixing these chemicals together to create a product with the right level of protection. On September 17th, 2019, someone submitted a question on Purito's website in the Q&A section that summarizes a lot of the concerns that were raised on the Reddit threads. I was wondering, this product only contains Uvinol T150 and Uvinol A+. Most other brands combine these two filters with some other actives like Tinosorb, Uvasorb HEB, or Ansulazole, for example. Guys, I don't know if I pronounced any of that right, so just bear with me. I've never seen an EU sunscreen that gets an SPF 50 with only these two filters. Wouldn't it be better to add something like Tinosorb S? So Purito actually responded to this question on their website, saying they would carefully discuss with their research team about including it if it doesn't transform the existing formula. There was another thing that made people concerned about the SPF marked on the label, especially NC Decoder's founder. NC Decoder, by the way, is a very useful product ingredient database that helps you understand what's in your products. So what the founder was concerned about was that not only were there only two filters, but the concentration of those two filters in the formula were extremely low and the numbers just didn't seem to add up to an SPF of 50+. So what are those numbers? As for the concentration, there is only 3% Uvinol A+ and 2% Uvinol T150 in the formula. And as for Purito's tested SPF number, they actually posted a video on October 28th, 2020 showing the results of a functional cosmetic testing report from June 12th, 2019, showing an SPF result of 84.5. Those numbers just don't seem to add up. So earlier this year, to get to the bottom of this, NC Decoder's founder ordered an in vitro SPF test from a Polish lab, which is a cheaper test because it's not performed on actual human skin, just to see if her suspicions had any validity to them at all. And it came back with a shocking number. The lab results came back with an SPF of 15.8. That's like 5 times lower than Purito's test at 84.5. So she ordered a second test. This time, an in vivo test using the same Polish lab, but on 10 people using the gold standard ISO 24444 method. That's significant because that is the level required by the European regulators to actually put an SPF claim on a bottle. So this is the real deal. I mean, it's a really, really expensive test to order as well because you're testing on real people. By the way, the test actually involves people getting sunburned. That's why it's so expensive. Anyway, the test result came back with an SPF of 19. And just to be sure, because the founder knew this was going to be shocking news, she ordered a third in vivo test. So the test is done on humans in a German lab. This time they did it with only 6 people because it is so much more expensive to get testing done in Germany. The test results came back and you guessed it, 19.2. None of these 3 tests came anywhere near the 84.5 that Purito published previously. After these results arrived, NC Decoder's founder posted this blog post on their site and also this Instagram post on Thursday, December 3rd, 2020. She really came through with those receipts because she published all 3 of those lab results online. So Purito Centella sunscreen, the one that we all fell in love with, which is labeled as an SPF of 50 plus, might actually be an SPF of only 19. That's right. The product we all thought was one of the most incredible sunscreen formulas out there turned out to actually be more like a slightly protective moisturizer. After this bombshell dropped, there was immediate fallout and backlash because they had such great relationships with a ton of influencers in the skincare space. Purito responded with this Instagram post on Friday, December 4th, 2020. Guys, it's a super long post that continues on even in the comments section. So in the post, Purito explains all of the people that's involved in bringing a sunscreen to market. There's the brand, Purito, that requests a formula from a manufacturer. There's the manufacturer that actually creates the formula, in this case, Naukos. There's the testing lab that actually tests for the SPF level and the PA level of the sunscreen. And last but not least, there's the regulator. In this case, the KFDA, which is just the Korean version of the FDA or the Food and Drug Administration. So Purito says that their role in bringing this sunscreen to market is that they basically requested the manufacturer, Naukos, to develop a product for them. They then basically say that they put all of their trust in the manufacturer to do their job and defend that decision by saying the manufacturer had a history of developing quality sunscreens and innovative formulas. The sunscreen was also officially approved by the KFDA before it was launched. And in terms of the actions that Purito was going to take, they said they looked into the manufacturer's registration with the KFDA and the authenticity of the registered documents, and they were assured that it wasn't a problem. The KFDA did legally approve the sunscreen. They are also going to be ordering in vivo and in vitro tests for all 3 of their sunscreens, and they say that they will be releasing those results publicly. They also say that they will be pausing sales of all 3 of their sunscreens, including the Comfy Water Sunblock, which I used to love. And as of Monday, December 6th, Korea time, Purito has pulled the products from their website. Okay, so let's talk about that for a second. So is it weird for Purito to leave the majority of the development and approval process to the manufacturer? So to get to the bottom of that, I spoke to a friend who's the CEO of a skincare company in the US who confirmed that it's actually not weird or sketchy for a brand to work with a manufacturer to develop the sunscreen formulation based on the brand specifications and for the manufacturer to take care of getting it tested and getting it approved by the regulator in the US. But one thing that still doesn't really sit that well with me is that Purito basically didn't question the SPF or PA levels, the number of filters that were used, or the amounts that were used, but yet some Redditors were able to pick up on that with very limited information. And even when Purito was asked on the Q&A section of their website, it didn't really seem like anything had changed after that. It wasn't until these results came out from INSEE Decoder and they got a flood of backlash that they actually started to take it seriously. But all that being said, it seems like they are now starting to do the right thing by retesting and pulling the product from the shelves in the meantime. The manufacturer is a company called Naukos. A quick Google search will show you that they are actually one of the top manufacturers in Korea. If you try to look up their website right now, you'll see that it's been taken down, which is super shady. But by the magic of Web Archive, we can see a snapshot from their website from May 28th, 2020. We can see that they've worked with brands like Amore Pacific, Innisfree, Mamond, Nature Republic, Tony Moly, and Vanilla Co., among others. And if taking your website down when there's a little bit of controversy is a little shady because that makes you look guilty, it actually gets even shadier. As Yamsmos78 points out on the Asian Beauty subreddit, the FDA actually sent Naukos a warning letter on February 14th, 2018, because significant violations of current good manufacturing practice, and they even put Naukos on an import alert list in the US. That's pretty bad. I mean, if you actually read the letter, it basically says that they didn't put in a process to ensure that what they're making is accurate or consistent, and some other really shady stuff, like they don't have good cleaning procedures for the equipment they're using. Like, oh my God. So all of this kind of makes me think that it's probably not an issue with a batch or two that INSEE Decoder just happened to test. It could be something much bigger than that. Okay. So the manufacturer is definitely kind of shady, but it was the testing company that got the 84.5 SPF. And that just seems way off. So could the manufacturers then blame the testing company? So I really don't think that the testing company can shoulder 100% of the blame, because Naukos is an experienced manufacturer and formulator. They should have known that 3% Juvenal A+ and 2% Juvenal T150 wasn't going to hit that SPF 50 plus threshold. So what about the regulators, the KFDA, that actually signed off on the SPF 50 plus on the label? Does this mean that we shouldn't trust Korean sunscreens at all? So it seems like the KFDA was probably just working off of the information that they were given by the manufacturer. And since this is a well-known manufacturer, they probably have a pretty good working relationship. But still, the manufacturer would usually have to submit a bunch of information to them. Not just the SPF testing results, but also the concentrations of medicinal ingredients, in this case, the chemical filters. So if that's true, how did the KFDA miss the low concentrations of only two chemical filters? Again, just the formulation alone raised some concerns by skincare nerds on Reddit. So I do want to point out that there have been even more insane examples of sunscreen issues not being caught by the FDA in the US. Don't write off everything Korean just because of this. We don't have enough information, and xenophobia targeting the Asian community has been super high with the pandemic, so don't jump to conclusions. Just to give you an example, a huge scandal broke in the US last year about a testing lab. So AMA Laboratories, which is in New York State, a top lab certifying results for tons of sunscreen brands and other skincare products, had allegedly been faking results for 30 years. There were even two FBI raids on the lab in 2017. And in August 2019, the FDA announced that the owner of AMA Laboratories had been arrested and charged with fraud for falsifying results from 1987 to April 2017. And some of their top staff have already pled guilty for fraud charges. And I can't overstate how wide-ranging that impact is, because AMA Laboratories was testing sunscreens worldwide. I mean, even in New Zealand, Cancer Society sunscreen labeled SPF 50+ was tested at AMA Laboratories and was affected. That sunscreen was later retested by Consumer NZ, a consumer protection nonprofit in New Zealand, at two different labs and only returned a maximum SPF of 30. Let me just let that sink in for a sec. The Cancer Society sunscreen didn't provide the amount of protection that was listed on the label. And that's pretty bad, because New Zealand has one of the highest rates of skin cancer in the world. And there are issues with US sunscreens as well. Consumer Reports has been doing testing on American sunscreens for a few years, and in 2017, 23 of the 60 sunscreens tested came back with SPF results at less than half of what was marked on the label. So that has been disputed, because their test methods aren't the same as what's required by sunscreen manufacturers to put a claim on the label. But still, this shows that there can be really big differences in sunscreen testing results worldwide. So my point is that this isn't just a Korean sunscreen issue. And I also want to be totally clear. I'm not bringing all of these issues up to say that the whole sunscreen industry is corrupt, or that the SPF protection on every sunscreen label is wrong. But what I do think is that this definitely raises some pretty troubling questions that need to be answered. Why didn't Purito catch the sunscreen filter issue when they were first developing the product, or look into it when it was brought to their attention on the Q&A section of their website? How was Naukos able to continue selling products into the US even when they were served an FDA warning letter that went unaddressed? And how was AMA Laboratories in the US able to get away with scamming their skincare product test results for 30 years? Now you know the facts. Let's talk about, where does all of that leave us? And what can you do now? So it seems like the manufacturer, Naukos, was definitely doing some shady stuff. Taking their website down when this all went down. Getting a warning letter from the FDA and being placed on an import alert list. So I think that other brands that use this manufacturer might also be affected too. Annie42 on the subreddit Asian Beauty pointed out that the Dear Claire's Soft Airy UV Essence, a pretty close dupe to the Purito Centella Unscented sunscreen, is also manufactured by Naukos. So it's likely that the Dear Claire's one is also affected. Okay, but what about Purito? Well, it's really hard to say, because we really don't know how much they knew. So we can't say they duped us, because we don't know if they knew and turned a blind eye, or if they intentionally did this, or they didn't know at all. I could definitely see a world where they went with a really well-known manufacturer that has worked with a ton of top brands in Korea and didn't ask too many questions, because they wanted to believe that this manufacturer was able to innovate on the formulation to get that SPF 50 plus rating while still feeling like you're not wearing any sunscreen at all, because isn't that the dream? But I could also see a world where the product development team at Purito just didn't ask too many questions when the results came back the way they wanted them to come back, even though they knew the filter percentages were low. That being said, I think that maybe there's enough evidence to suggest that this isn't just an isolated incident with Purito sunscreen. I'd like to see more companies being put under the spotlight to make sure that what they say we're getting is actually correct. And more companies offering retesting of their sunscreens and posting all of those results because of what's happened. As consumers, we should definitely demand more transparency from the brands that we're buying from. Put that pressure on the brands to show us that their products are actually legit. And nowhere is this more important than sunscreens. So it'll be really interesting to see what Purito does from here, and if anyone else is going to test other sunscreens manufactured by Naukos, like the Dear Claire's one. What are Purito's test results going to come back as? What will Purito do? Will they decide to relabel if those results come back closer to 20 than 84? Will they do a recall? Now we've covered all the issues, let's talk about some practical things. Like, what do you do now if you've already bought it? I've read a lot of comments from people who don't like sunscreen say that they actually like the sunscreen and this is what got them into wearing sunscreen. So if you're one of those people, SPF 19 is still better than SPF 0. So it's not totally useless. The Skin Cancer Foundation says, regular daily use of SPF 15 sunscreen can reduce your risk of developing squamous cell carcinoma by about 40% and lower your melanoma risk by 50%. And when you use enough of it, SPF 15 sunscreen still blocks out 93% of UVB radiation. I personally prefer a much higher SPF and would recommend an SPF of at least 30, but if your options are to use this or use nothing, using this up is not the end of the world and you can always switch to a different sunscreen after you use this one up. And as for me, for now, I'm planning on using this on the tops of my hands. For my face, I'm switching back to an old favorite. It's the Elta MD UV Clear SPF 46. It's the one for breakout prone skin. But let me know down below what alternatives you're planning to use. Are you going back to some of your OGs as well? And also don't forget that there are other ways to protect yourself from the sun, like wearing a hat or walking on the shadier side of the street or keeping it 2020 and just not going outside at all. Okay, so that's it for now. I might do an update later as the story unfolds. So if you like this video and want to follow along, give your girl a like and subscribe and hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on any more informative skincare videos like this one. See you next time.